Variability is what I would expect to see in a biological system, because even if you have completely identical genotypes of, say, bacterial cells, there could be subtle differences in the timing of expression of genes within those cells to give these identical genotypes different what are called phenotypes, different traits, even though they have exactly the same genotype. So the point is that variability is something we see in the natural world all of the time. It is just there.
The rule of thumb is if there is variation in your experiment that is seemingly random, you can correct for it by increasing your sample size. So if you have a few samples, the effect of random variation is going to have a large impact on the result that you ultimately report. But if you have a huge pool of samples, those random fluctuations are going to kind of cancel each other out across all of the samples. But it will not correct for systemic biases. So that's things like instrumentation bias. So if you have some systemic bias that is affecting your results, increasing the sample size will not correct for it. So one example is like if you have a scale that is broken and it always overestimates the weight that it reports, like it adds 2 kilograms on every value. You can measure one sample, you can measure a million samples, they're always going to have that error. So increasing the sample size does not correct for bias, but it will correct for random noise.
To understand the variability in your data is also important. The only way to do that is to create a sufficient sample size. For example, if one just has a duplicate measurement or triplicate measurement, one's often in a case where one of the points is quite different from the other. In that case, it's hard to know if it's a technical variation or it's a very weird outlier, or if it's really an inherent variability in your biological system. So obviously, generating more replicas and examining the variation of data from more samples would clarify that.
But that's not always the best option, though, because the number of replicates that you include expands the size of your experiment. And then you may quickly run into impracticalities where you just cannot conduct this experiment with the level of replication that you need to move the noise away to the periphery.
As you add more samples, you're going to begin exhausting other resources. So the amount of time that it takes to set up an experiment is finite because there's only 24 hours in a day and you only have so much energy to work with at the bench at any given time. So if you want to do 1,000 samples versus 10,000 samples, you really need to consider what it's going to do to your body, to your energy levels, to your mental state. Eventually, you're going to get fatigued, and it's going to be a lot harder to increase the sample size after that. Another case is when adding more samples becomes prohibitively expensive, or it begins to take up too much space. So when you're trying to decide how many biological samples you need in a particular experiment, that's when the power calculation is really helpful.